for out the reason we were getting the copyright strike is from the introduction. But it also says a little note next to it that this user allows you to use it in your videos. However, I don't know if there's a difference between them letting us use it for our videos and then capitalizing, like,
monetarily.
Monetarily off of it, if it's still allowed or if we have to give them a kickback. So I think in the grand scheme of things, within the very near future, we should just record our own custom shit.
We'll make it.
Yeah, we can make it, bro. We got the little beat machine there, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Push, push, push the J2 podcast. Push, push.
We'll make it way more interesting than what we have.
J2. Time to talk some shit. Old one, bro. I was like, yo, this sounds cool. What if I slow it down and make it deeper?
Actually, that wasn't bad. Is this a cigar holder?
Time to talk, yes. Aesthetically,
one of these.
Dude, aesthetically pleasing, not functional at all.
It didn't hold it?
You put it in there, bro. You try to take a drink, you burn your eye.
Oh, you're trying to take a drink with the cigar in it?
Yeah. Like, dude, something's going to be. All right. I'm going to give you a layup here. Don't take the bait. If I'm smoking and drinking, smoking a cigar and drinking, at all times I want something in my mouth, whether it's a cigar or the drink. Don't take the bait. You know, so there's never going to be a time where I put the drink and the cigar down. I'm either putting the cigar down because I'm taking a sip of my drink or putting my drink down because I'm puffing the cigar. You can't get past that. I said that all the time. Something needs to be in my mouth. Just a cigar, a drink, dick, something.
Interesting. Very interesting.
But anyways, yeah, dude. So that's that. That settles that. The dictation. What did you talk about earlier? Declamation. Dick and Terry. What was that word?
The fuck?
The word, bro. The word.
Decletage.
No, that's declavage. That's tetlavage.
Declavage.
Dick clavage.
Dichotomy.
Dichotomy, bro.
Yeah.
Dichotomy.
There's a dichotomy.
20,000 bonus points for somebody that can leave a comment telling me what dichotomy means.
Without looking it up. You can't look it up.
What does it mean? What does it mean in your definition?
Well, it's contrast. That's the actual definition.
Oh,
but I actually, in all honesty, just being truthful, I knew it had like dual definition. I didn't know it was directly in absolute as, just contrast. Like
contrast.
Yeah. So like we were obviously we were talking about poker, and it's like, you know, like a check. What does a check mean? Check could mean strength. It could mean weakness. How do you take a check?
More often than not, it means weakness. Like
that's how I feel.
When I'm thinking about it, I feel like, yes, I don't ever base my decision on the exception to the rule. Like every now and then, somebody limps in with aces, but I'm not gonna fuck with the way I play because sometimes they could limp in with aces.
Absolutely,
I'm always assuming that if they limped in, their hand's weak. If they're checking, their hand's weak. Right. Will I get caught sometimes because they're check raising like an idiot? Yeah. But you know what it does? It lets me fold a fucking stupid hand that I would have kept pouring money into the pot anyway.
It's kind of like when you ask somebody a question and they're just silent. They don't answer. Is that an answer? Is that their answer? Or is that like...
So I think
they're guilty. Not guilty, but I'm saying like it could mean dual.
I think people really overestimate their ability to use speech play. Meaning,
oh, you're talking about poker.
And they have too much stock in their own speech play, thinking that their live tells or their speech tells are good. I think, you know, in some shit games with easy players, silence could be a sign of, you know, like weakness, like they're afraid to move, like a deer in the headlights, they don't say anything.
Absolutely.
But I think when you actually get to anything higher than maybe like 2-5,
yeah.
Most of the people you play with, the best players in the world, are just going to sit there stoic and not give you any information regardless of its weakness or strength.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's a strong player. That's a very strong player.
Yeah.
That can sit there stoic and
not
move.
That Tom Dwan stare.
Yeah. And then, like, oh, something was in my eye. Like, fucking, that's what he always says. Like, the lights.
Oh, it's a hurt of my eyes blur. Dude, he was the GOAT. But anyways, I don't want to get into it. We fucking
wasted
the whole podcast. And then you came on, bro. I gave you like 2 or 3 tips. You came out and crushed the game. So good shit.
Stop, bro.
Good shit. I mean, everybody saw it, bro. It was on camera.
I just literally had to prove that at any point in time,
who did you have to prove it to?
Everybody.
Did you doubt it?
I never doubt it.
So you just wanted everybody else to know?
It sounded like you doubted it.
I don't doubt it. I always said I give you credit. I think you have the ability to be a good player. So you didn't prove anything to me. All you did was you proved that my tips were correct.
If you took
the advice I gave you. Who the fuck's Will, bro? It's weird today. Went to the barbershop, obviously. You already saw the dome. Dude, the barbershop is such
a... Let me ask you, why did you do that?
Same reason as earlier when you asked me off camera. Just felt like it.
Yeah?
Broke the fourth wall.
Are you depressed?
Yeah. I'm sad, so I shaved my head. I was so tired of my hair. It was killing me.
No, but there must be some kind of like... is it just...
I just felt like it, bro. There's not really a lot of logic. I mean, there's guys, you know, like you, for example. Your hair has been relatively the same since I've known you.
Yeah.
You know, you're kind of just that. That's your thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. Every couple of months, I get bored and I switch up my hair. Like, you've seen me with long hair. You've seen me with, you know,
braids
on top. You've seen me with a fade. You've seen me with,
like
a comb over. You've seen me with a long beard, short beard. And now you see the fucking bald dome. I switch it up, man. I get bored. You're a creature of habit, aren't you?
We are a creature of habits.
I'm not. I have no habits. Not one habit. I've never had a habit.
Never had a habit.
Not one habit. I don't even like fucking rabbits because it rhymes with habit.
I don't even like waking up at the same time.
I don't like fucking rabbits. You're like, yeah, me neither. Don't do that.
I fucked a rabbit once.
Yeah?
My dad fucked a rabbit once. Not literally fucked a rabbit.
Okay. I was going to say, you gotta continue. I need a little more context there.
Yeah, when I was younger,
Hey, is that thing on camera? Just so I know, George, can you see this Diet Coke bottle? Can you move that, please?
Is it in the camera shot?
Definitely is now.
How about now?
It just makes us look like cussies that drink Diet Coke.
Oh, God, water. Yeah, my dad fucking... He drowned a rabbit in front of me.
All I could picture was George trying to discreetly pull the Diet Coke out of the frame and knocking shit over, knocking the cameras over, bro. You said your dad fucked a rabbit in front of you?
Not fucked a rabbit. He drowned a rabbit in front of me.
Why?
Because so I was living in Florida.
Rabbits talked back to him?
Yeah, no. And the rabbit's foot got caught in like the plastic. We were trying to protect the rabbit from like rain and stuff. It was outside in the cage.
You did the opposite of that.
Well, his right? His foot was caught in the plastic, so it was getting infected. It was swollen, whatever. And my dad was like, "All right, hey, look, this rabbit's about, you know, his foot is infected. We got to kill it."
You couldn't do it more. I've read that drowning in like is up there with burning to death as the most painful way to go. Like the most torturous way to go. Like when you drown, George, maybe you could look this up for us. But when you drown, like not only do you suffocate and choke to death, but like your internal organs swell up and burst with water.
That sucks. I would never want that to happen to me. Or burning.
Like, or a rabbit. Just get that shot. Poor rabbit, bro.
Yeah. So he took it over to the pool and was like, "All right, we got to kill it," and just drowned it.
Oh, man. Tapped. Most people would just break its neck or cut its head off or shoot it, you know, or pull its fingernails off. I don't know. Anything's better than drowning it.
I guess so.
Yeah. A lot of rabbits around here, dude, which is cool. That's how I know I moved to a nice neighborhood. Where I grew up, there was always just rats and cats everywhere. Now where I live, there's like little bunnies and shit.
Like fucking
around.
Snow White. There's like blue jays.
Just blue jays on my windowsill.
Chirping.
Good morning, Josh. There's no spiders here. There's only butterflies.
Butterfly spiders.
Yeah. The fuck's going on upstairs, bro? All kinds of shit getting dropped.
It says drowning is the most painful. It says that.
That's what I thought, bro.
The surface area inside your lungs can expand up to the size of a tennis court, which doesn't even make sense to me.
Well, what is that actually?
Surface area, bro. Think about that's like if they're ripped and spread out.
The size of a tennis court?
What? Yeah. Well, because think about it. Your lungs contract and shit. So there's natural like flexibility, almost like an accordion.
But you know, the size of a tennis court?
But think about it. If you see an accordion closed, you're like, oh, it's not that big. But because of the folds and everything, you can really fucking pull that shit way out. So if your lungs do all that and come down to this size with all those folds, that shit could really... You know what's a better idea? You ever see those little plastic...
No, I get what you're
balls?
Saying.
Think about those plastic balls, right? That have like all the... They're like little skinny pieces of plastic that expand. You pull them out. It's like, wow. Wow. You got to look up that toy so he knows what I'm talking about.
But the size of a tennis court? I mean, bro, you might as well say a football field.
Well, just in my head, in comparison, bro, like those little tennis balls, they look like tennis balls, and then you expand it up to a fucking bigger than a beach ball. I don't know, man. It does sound a bit big, tennis court.
But a tennis court, though? Like, what source was that?
Alex Jones. Not a clue. Mythbusters. Fuck.
Yeah, it sounds kind of like, that sounds a little extreme.
Yeah. So how often do you go to the barbershop?
I try to go every 2 weeks. I was going like once a week just for the cleanup and then the cut. Cleanup, cut, you know, that kind of thing.
So like cleanup, cleanup, cut. Cleanup, cleanup, and cut.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Yeah, I go every week, dude, and I've been going to the same barber still. Shout out Ann Cambio for, I don't know, man, close to 10 years now.
So he bicked you?
Or Yeah.
Why didn't you do it yourself?
Like, because I go every week anyway, you know, for the beard, the cleanup.
Oh, right.
And I had mad hair, bro. Like, if you want to shave your own head, dude, that's a messy thing. You got to hit it with the clippers a couple times, then bick it. Pain in the dick. Plus, I need the beard. My beard grows back so fast, dude. Like, I have to go. I mean, I don't shave it at home, but... Plus, I don't know. It's, you know, I get a nice hot towel head massage, face massage. You know, it's just the
from
steam thing. Yeah. Steam, all the steam on me and shit. It's almost like a little mini spa day, you know, like kind of my day where I'm in the chair for an hour just getting pampered. You know, I'm trying to convince him to do hand massages and shit, but he's not into it yet. I told him, I'm just like, listen, man, like the barber experience to me anyways is kind of evolving from just like a little lineup or a haircut.
Right.
So like, hey, man, I want to spend a couple hours in here and feel great when I leave. You know, like take care of my skin, my face, my eyebrows, clean my ears if you want. I don't give a shit.
That's how it was in Korea. You go to Korea, they like, not only do they cut your hair, they put your, you know, fingernail, your hands in like warm water. Yeah. They massage your hands. They massage your neck. Yeah.
They blow you.
All kinds of shit. They blow you.
It's dope.
Yeah.
Going to Korea.
Pretty interesting.
North or south?
South. I was in South Korea, which was fucking nuts, man. It was crazy.
Better than north, probably.
In fact, when we went over there, like, so normally stateside, you know, like colonel and above, they're very, you know, like, hey, I'm the leader, I gotta set the example, whatever. In Korea, they're like on the bar drinking, pounding drinks, and like, hey, fuck it, I'm not stateside, I'm just gonna get fucking hammered.
Get hammered.
It was nuts. Dun, 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 dun. We were going to
want beer?
This little section called A-Town right outside the base.
Oh, Atlanta?
Yeah. No, it was for American Town. And it all...
It's like in Korea, they got rickshaws with 20s and American flags on them, bro.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Oh, shit.
Right when you get off the base, there was a certain little... shack where everybody, it was tradition, like before you go out into the A-Town to drink for the night, you had to go to the shack and down a pitcher of green soju, which was, they called green slime, which was like, you know, you don't taste it or anything, it doesn't have a scent or any, so like you would get fucking hammered.
Can you pull up what soju is? Green soju?
Yeah.
I just want to look at it.
Green soju, just soju,
up and I'll look at the
soju in general. And
no, don't worry about it. I'll look here. Oh, wow. And
it's amazing. And then you would go out into the town.
Oh, it's beer, bro.
No, it is definitely not beer. It's like...
Okay.
Something else. I'm sorry. I
didn't tell you about the cop thing. I'm like, okay. It was definitely... You're fucking dying, bro. I was belly laughing, man. You're stupid, bro. And then you got Judy's just, bro, Judy is growing on me every week playing there with her. She's so funny.
She's like really opening up.
But then she'll just shut down immediately and just get super aggressive with you. Like, oh, how come you're sitting this one out? Because I want to. All right. Like, okay.
I'm like, you don't like it in the can? She's like, sometimes.
Oh, my God. But yeah, back to... So the barbershop, man, I've been going there for years, so it's almost like, I'm not saying, you know, we're best friends, but it's like, we, you know, you develop a relationship. So I'm in there, bro, we're breaking balls and shit. And I recently switched my, I used to go every week in the morning, you know what I mean, early in the morning. Now I go Thursday nights. So I'm like his last cut of the day, because mine typically takes longer, you know what I mean? I'm in that chair for a while, I got a massive head, I get like extra shit. And it's just such a vibe in the barbershop, dude, like towards the end of the shift, the end of their week. You know what I mean? Like I'm sitting in the chair. One of the other barbers just comes and brings me a drink. I don't even know what it is. He's like, yo, here, nobody's drinking with me. Take this. I'm like, all right.
Yeah.
I'm like, luckily for you,
I only drink on nights we do the podcast, so I'm drinking. He's like, I thought you did the podcast on Sunday. I'm like, yeah, but when I decided I'm only drinking on nights of the podcast, we bumped it to 2 days a week. But, you know, just chilling in there, bro. It's funny. Like, everybody's – there's nothing more – there's no better way to describe what it's like just hanging out with dudes than at a barbershop.
Hmm?
Like, if you had to describe, like, what it means to just, like, yo, I'm just chilling with dudes, you know, acting like dudes, talking like dudes, it's at a barbershop. You're just bullshitting, yeah. Having, like, stupid takes on all different things. Just
yeah. In fact, there's actually a couple podcasts out there that they do it in a barbershop.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. That's pretty dope.
Matt Hoffa, who's a...
Remember that show? There used to be a show called The Shop on, like, MTV or something. It was, like, a little reality show.
Same kind of concept.
Same concept, like, but the problem with reality TV is, like, they think Americans are so stupid, because most of us are, but it's so obviously scripted, you know what I mean? There's reality shows, and it's like, dude, if you could just keep it, and that's kind of the beautiful thing about podcasts, is even though it's, like, it's not, like, it's intentionally recorded, but there's nothing scripted about what we do, you know what I mean? Like, it's just, getting a legit conversation. Obviously, bro, we don't even make sense. How could it be scripted? But that a lot of problems with reality TV, man, is like it's almost cheesy, you know? Like, I'd rather watch something really scripted or something not scripted at all. I don't like that half in between WWE shit.
Well, you know, like in those reality shows, they purposely set the stage with certain personalities to conflict, and you know, you got the gay guy, you got the black guy, you got the gay black guy, you got the, you know, the horny white chick.
You got the good boy, the bad boy, the good bad boy, the half good, half bad, half boy.
Yes, exactly.
That's
they put them all together in a house. And
the Bo Burnham song, bro. That line forever has cracked me up. He's like, he's talking about like women not knowing what they want. He's like, these bitches, they want a good boy, a bad boy, a good bad boy, a half good, half bad, half boy.
Speaking of women, and like, what do you think about like this is a very specific question. What do you think about women, like, over the last, let's say, 10 years, how much I think that the female perception of relationships and everything, their viewpoint has changed so much from, you know, let's say gender role specifics to, hey, fuck that, I'm independent.
That's just part of, I think, like, natural progression, you know what I mean? It's such a cultural thing, you know what I mean? It's like the way that this country, when you think about how we've progressed evolved. Over the years, yeah, and evolved as a people, it's kind of, I'm not surprised by it.
Yeah.
You know? It's, it is what it is, you know?
You think women and men are equal?
No. That's such a stupid thing to say.
All right.
There's a reason, right? I mean, just for the it could sound like I'm oversimplifying, right. But just for the sheer fact that
simple question.
Right. Just for the obvious fact that there are separate athletic leagues for men and for women shows that we're not equal.
Right.
You know, what
about legally? Like, do you think that women and men on a legal standpoint should, like, you know, like, you'll hear a lot of feminists say, like, equal pay. You'll hear, you know, stuff like that.
So this is probably going to get some heat. The problem with equal pay
is that women want it.
Just don't deserve it. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Is that, you know, like,
women want it.
I don't believe in this pay gap. You know, I really don't. Because, first of all, it's illegal. You know what I mean? Like, and not just like legally, but I mean, like, most companies, almost every company you work for,
yeah,
if you could prove that you're being paid less than somebody that does the exact same job at you at the same quality, and you can prove that just because you're a woman you're being paid less, that company's gonna get sued. You're gonna sue that company to shit, you know what I mean?
Right.
The problem is that just because we do the same job, I was actually watching a video or reading some shit on TikTok the other day of the female soccer players talking about why they don't get paid the same as much as men, even though they outperform it and they do the same job.
But
they make it further in the World Cup. I think the women are probably, they won the World Cup, like, what, 2 or 3 years in a row? Or 2 or 3 World Cups in a row?
Right.
But the thing is, it's not the same job.
Of course. You know?
You're not competing against the same caliber of player. You're not competing against the best in the world. You're competing against the best women in the world.
Which you're not the best, the second best.
Yeah, but the thing is, like, you know, like, if you take the
World Cup women's champions, right? Which I believe is the USA most recently. And you put them against any men's nation, whoever finished dead last in the World Cup in the men's, it's not going to be a competitive match.
Right, right, right.
You know what I mean? So, like, the fight for equal pay is, it's silly in that sense, but you know what I mean? Don't get me wrong, bro. If I'm a doctor and a man is, and a woman is a doctor, and we do the exact same job at the exact same level, of course I think she should be paid the same amount as me. But I think there are professions where women probably make more than men on average because there are more women doing a better job in the industry.
Right, right, right. And maybe, I think I'm along those.
And I could be wrong, but I would say, like, teachers, nurses, CNAs.
Yeah.
I would assume that there's more women in those fields doing a better job.
I don't even understand, to tell you the truth, I don't understand the woman's fight for equality. Like, I mean, we're obviously biologically different. We're obviously chemically, you know, different. How we handle stressful situations, how we handle any situations, really. I mean, we're just two different human beings altogether. Right. And I don't think there's anything necessarily wrong with that. But for some reason, there's feminists out there that believe that it's kind of like a shot to them to say that. To say, you know, like if I stated, you know, I think women are more nurturing than men. Like, to me, that's like almost a biological fact. Do I have any basis for that? I don't. It's just my world view.
Well, of course you do. You're a parent. You know what I mean? Well, you can see the way that you parent your child versus the way that her mother parents her. You know, and I see that every day.
But imagine if you were with a woman that, let's say, is not more nurturing than, let's say, the
father. Yeah, but
you
know what I'm saying? That's the outlier. I don't like to put my opinion on these unique situations, you know?
Well, I guess what I'm saying
overall, mothers are more nurturing than fathers.
I agree with you. Yeah. I wouldn't base it off just, like, let's say, my personal experience, but I know that, like, even over my lifetime, I've been called misogynist, you know, like, whatever. And I believe that
many people don't even know what that word means. It's just a fucking buzzword.
It's a buzzword, just along, like, same as, like, all these other buzzwords.
Nazi, homophobe, racist.
Yes,
like, bro.
Yes.
I've never met a person in my life that's afraid of gay people. What is a homophobe, bro? You know what I mean? Like, I've never met somebody that's like, oh my God, gay.
I don't think, you know what? What's crazy is that I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with having gender role specifics. Put it this way.
I would agree.
If two people were in a relationship, which happens all the time, obviously, and certain tasks have to be done, right? And you split those tasks up, like, okay, I'm going to do this, you do that, you're good at this, I'm good at that. What is wrong with that? What is?
Nothing. Well, bro, there's a perfect clip on that I see all the time. What's, George, what's the actor that plays, you know, in the Avengers, you have Iron Man, and then, I'm sorry, you have Captain America, and then, like, his sidekick, the black dude? You know his name?
Jerome?
Maybe if you look up the cast. I want to know this actor's name. Just look up Avengers cast. He's not the Falcon or something, is he?
Don Cheadle?
No. That's Iron Man's guy. I'm talking about Captain America's dude. He's a black dude. What else is he playing, bro?
But I just find it strange that the mere fact that
that's the guy. He's got a little gap in his teeth. Yeah. So he had.
Didn't he play Tupac? Clip.
I don't know. There's a great clip of him on, I want to say, it's some talk show.
Yeah.
And they're just asking him about gender roles. And, you know, the interviewer asks him, like, all right, so if you're with a woman and you want a sandwich, and he's just like, then you make daddy a sandwich. And she's like, but what? And he cuts her off. He's like, no. You make daddy a sandwich if I want to. And she's like, how can you say that? And he goes, all right, let me ask you something. We go out to eat.
Yeah.
We split in the bill. If I tell you we're going to go Dutch, what are you going to say?
Fuck you.
Exactly. We go back to the car. I don't open the car door for you. What are you going to tell me?
You're not a gentleman.
Exactly. Open the door. We're out together, right? Somebody says something slick to you. They talk shit to you. What do you expect me to do?
Exactly.
So I agree with you. So you make daddy a sandwich? And that's kind of his philosophy. And it sounds silly, almost like it's satirical, but that's kind of like what sums up gender roles. At the end of the day, you know, I think, you know, Sasha's amazing, you know. And she doesn't do it because I force her into these gender roles. Like, naturally, our relationship just kind of evolved to, you know, like, financially, I handle some things. And, you know, when it comes to, like, nurturing and taking care of the home, she's amazing at that. But at the end of the day, that's a very fair dynamic, because if some shit goes down in the middle of the night, if somebody's banging on the door, if she thinks she hears something, she's not coming down here to check that out.
Right.
You know what I mean?
She's obviously going to ask you to do it.
And if I hear it, I'm not waking up her to go check it out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think there's a very, very natural role anyways.
Because this is not something that was taught to me. This is something that's instinctive, that's primitive inside me.
It amazes me that, like, I don't even know where it stems from and where the root is, you know, for this, like, push, this I don't even know where it comes from, because it seems like it comes from the media, but, I mean, that's just, like, kind of like a, you know, yeah, I'm guessing, we're like, they're almost forcing their audience, which is society, to be kind of the same, homogenized.
Homogenized, good word. I know what that means.
Yeah, like
the exact definition means to make all the same.
Right. Yeah.
Most milk is homogenized.
Correct. So I mean, like, but why? Why would? What is the purpose of trying to push genders the same, sex is the same, race is the same? Like, what do we benefit out of that? Except for almost delusion. Like, what is the outcome? What is the reason for that? And that's always baffled me. I'm like, why are we trying to push everybody to believe that everything should be the same? Why can't we be different? Why can't we celebrate our differences? Why can't you be black, I be white, and okay, that's cool. You like chicken, I can't dance. You know, whatever. Whatever those stereotypes are. Why does it always have to be like, oh, you can't say that. You can't say this. You can't say this about that sex. You can't say this. So, you know, it's like, it's crazy.
I think it's insanity. There's a beautiful thing about living in the real world, because you keep saying to me, you can't say this. You can't say that. But so much of how your life is plays out is the circle that you keep. Because I do say those things, you know, and in my circles, we say what we want, you know, and we realize we're all different. We don't think that we're the same. You know, we make jokes. We make stereotype jokes. You know, we just talk to each other like people.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, not like fucking cookie cutter cutouts that we're supposed to act like, you know. It's because I feel like here's the problem, bro, is the media, it's like a big weapon that you can use to feed the masses information.
Sure.
And that they'll have us believing that, like you just said, everybody thinks this way. Or everybody's saying this now. Everybody's saying that now.
Right.
But when you sit with a fucking 50 people that you actually know in real life, it's a lot more rational. You know, it's a lot more laid back and chill. Like, if you get caught in an echo chamber on fucking, you know, Facebook or, like, Instagram, whatever, these platforms are programmed to feed you more of the kind of shit that you engage with. You know, and most people engage with shit they disagree, like, oh no, that's stupid, that's not right, that's wrong. You know what I mean? Like, think about it. You post a lot of topics that you know are controversial.
Of course.
And it's the same 5 to 10 people that disagree with you wholeheartedly and they respond. And that's because they see your shit more often because they're always engaging with it.
Right.
So from your perspective, it's like, and people that agree with you don't usually say shit. They'll just like it and keep it moving.
Yeah, right.
You know?
Absolutely.
So from your perspective, you're probably like, fuck, man, I think this and everybody else disagrees with me. What are they doing in the world right now? What kind of information are they giving us? But the reality is you sit down with 30 people, most of us are kind of like in the middle on the same page with most issues. And even the shit that we disagree with, you know, like, because you and I have, bro, people would not realize it sometimes. I feel like we're both level-headed the most. Like, I'm going to give you an example. Abortion, right?
Yeah. We disagree.
We disagree. Like, you know, we disagree, and there's a hard line that we disagree on.
Absolutely.
But it's like 90% of what abortion is, we agree on. It's just a small part of it that we disagree on.
Well, it's funny that you bring that up because, yeah, I do. I actually believe that no matter what side that you, not you specifically, I'm saying anybody, stands on or takes a stance on, I think we all agree that there's a common denominator there. For instance, and I'll give you a perfect example, like gun control and, you know, the left, or let's say somebody more liberal would say, you know, hey, look, there's a lot of mass shootings. We don't want people to get killed. I don't think the right is going, well, we want more people killed. Like, I think we agree the fact that we don't want people killed either.
No shit, bro.
You know, it's just an abortion. Same exact thing. We don't want – nobody wants babies to be killed and murdered and stuff like that. It's just a matter of, like, you know, taking the conversation maybe up a level and saying, you know, well, we got to find some kind of common ground.
Right. You need, like, a starting point where you agree on something. For, like, with mass shootings – nobody wants more mass shootings except the psychos that are shooting motherfuckers.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? Like, but here's the thing. It's like there's a big argument here that, no, if we take away the guns, they're not going to happen, because then owning these guns would be illegal. shooting up a school is already illegal. Like, these are not the these are not the motherfuckers that are like, eh, I'm not trying to break that law today. You know, like, so it's almost like it doesn't make sense to make, I don't know, bro. I didn't want to get into it. It's,
well, you know what? Okay, so let's take a couple steps back, going back to the whole gender role thing really fast. I think, which is strange, that many women would find it degrading or condescending to say that there are gender roles. For whatever reason, they just you say, hey, look, you know what? I think that you should take care of this, the children, the and being more nurturing and whatever. And they take that as like it's a, not an insult, but like they're lesser of a person.
Like an inferior.
Yes. Yeah. When in reality, it's like, it's not that you're lesser of a person. I mean, it's just that, look, there's...
That's something you do better than I do.
Yeah, we have, let's say we have 100 tasks. You're taking 50 and I'm taking 50. Pick your 50. What are you good at? What am I good at? Let's put, you know, let's do it that way.
Yeah.
I mean, even Christianity says, you know, like, you know, women should submit to their husbands, not because they're less of a person, but because there's an understanding that men are just more dominant, you know, and if... It's like that 50-50 kind of, hey, look, I have to be this way. You got to be this way so to make it work.
Well, physical dominance is the first thing, the obvious thing that we have over women.
Of course.
Right. But and the reason I think that ties into what you just said, bro, is at the end of the day, physical dominance as a man.
It matters.
It's the only thing that matters.
Yeah.
And when I say that, I know it sounds silly at face value. It's like, no, it doesn't. But, you know. Well, you and I are in a disagreement, right?
Yeah.
Let's start with you make more money than me.
Sure.
Or you know what? Let's take it. You're smarter than me, right? Jay, you're smarter than me. We're arguing. I get upset. I'm like, well, fuck you. I make more money than you. Blah, blah, blah. You know, we take it a step further. Well, it doesn't matter, dude. Now you tell me you've accomplished more than me, right? And I go, well, I'm better than this at you. If this gets heated enough to where it becomes physical.
Right.
If you can kill me with your hands, nothing that I've done, nothing about me matters. At the end of the day, it all comes down to the physical, the dominant, or the how dominant. Blah, blah, blah,
blah, blah. I know exactly what you're saying.
You know what I mean? It comes down to what you can do physically.
My ass.
Exactly, bro.
Yeah.
You know, and now I'm talking back to a primitive thing because at the end of the day, that's who ate.
Right.
You know, like if you and I are hungry and there's one rabbit, I'm eating.
Right.
Or exactly. You're eating.
Yeah.
You know, one
survival
of our families.
Of the fittest.
That's. I know that we're not really there yet, but that's where so much of this stems from. That's where so much of it comes from because it's literally in our DNA. You know, at the end of the day, bro, it's in our DNA that women are nurturers and take care of the family, take care of the home, raise the children.
Right.
And the men
are
provide.
Protectors.
Provide, protect, do all that shit. So I think, but I also think, you know, like you made a comment and you said that, you know, most women will take it this way or feel like offended. I'm willing to bet, bro, and I firmly believe that most women are cool with gender roles and cool with being stay-at-home moms and cool with taking care of the house. I truly believe that most women are okay with
that. You know what? I actually agree with
you. But again, I think that, you know, the social media will have you believe in that, like, there's a huge women's... At the end of the day, bro, there's women's marches. I bet you less than 10% of the women in a given city are going to these fucking marches. Because the other women are sitting at home, getting manicures every other week, you know, chilling, drinking mimosas every 2 days. And they're like, can y'all not fuck this up for us? Like, like, yo, the kids are finally in school now. Like, I got like a good 6 hours a day where I'm just like, all right, sweep, mop, laundry, then I'm chilling. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'd be probably hard-pressed to agree that most women don't like it because I think the general consensus amongst women would be like, yeah, it's cool. Do they think they should be forced into them? No. And no, I don't think many men think that either. Like, if you have a wife that doesn't want to stay home and wants to work and wants to put the kids in daycare,
yeah,
of course, there's, you know what? There's a man for you. There's a man that's going to be okay with that.
Sure.
You know what I mean? But that could be the reason that you guys don't
the
work. Because, like, that, I don't believe that. I would never believe that. You know what you said?
They're called guys.
Yeah, they're gay.
They're gay. They're called betas.
But you know what I mean? It's like, you know, I don't think anybody should be forced into a role that they don't want to do.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah.
But I don't consider it forcing. Like, if let's say one day Sasha, you know, decided, hey, I want to do this. I don't want to take care of the house anymore. And we sell our kids. You know, my thought would be, listen, if you can figure out a way to do this and take care of all of your shit still, I'm good with that. But nothing that we have going on is going to be sacrificed because you want to get a job. You know, you're going to still take care of the house. You're going to still take care of the kids. You're going to cook the meals. You're going to do that. That isn't me forcing her into something. That's saying, hey, in order for this to work, this is how it has to happen. If you decide that this doesn't happen, then this doesn't work.
You
know what?
I believe that you have that right as a male, like, as just a human being.
The same as she has the right to say, well, fuck it, I'm out.
Yeah, it's just come down to preference. Like me personally, I don't want to be with somebody that smokes, right? Now somebody might say, like...
Even though you smoke.
No, I'm saying smoke cigarettes, right?
Oh, bro.
I'm not into somebody that smokes cigarettes. Right.
Yeah, it's a preference.
They might look at me like, oh, who do you think you are? You know, like whatever, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, listen, it's just my preference. I'm not saying that I'm a better human than you. I'm not saying.
Well, you definitely make better decisions.
Yeah.
Like, smoking is such a weird thing, dude. Like, it's crazy to me how many people picked up smoking, like, from a child. And it could be, again, I don't know if the information wasn't out there, but for as long as I know, as long as I can remember, smoking caused cancer. Like, from everything that I've known, I've learned in my life, dude, cigarettes, there are zero pros to them and just a laundry list of cons, you know, like teeth, fingernails, smell,
in all
money,
honesty,
cancer.
Just like there's everything else good. In today's media, it was the media that kind of put it out there.
Thanks, Dwayne.
Advertised it as it being cool, right? And there never used to be the Surgeon General's warning on really? Cigarettes. Yeah, back in the day.
Bro, there are some countries where it might even be some states, but where they're forced to print like specific diseases and ailments, and I think even photos of the symptoms on cigarette boxes.
Yeah. I don't think
really?
It does.
No. God damn it, George. You got to get sick on our podcast. Hey, for whoever told George that he thinks I hate him, you're right. No, I'm kidding. We love Jorge.
That's my only feedback.
He's like, hey, I really like that podcast, but why does that dude hate you? No.
Let's dive into that. Why do you hate George?
I mean, how much time we got? Kid. So, oh, shit. You got that on the feed so the viewers can see, right? Yeah, so that's what I'm saying, bro. Like, imagine what a fucking mongoloid you have to be to see that and still say, I'm going to risk it.
Well, because the reality is that doesn't compare to how they used to advertise it as
but
being cool.
But that's how they advertise it now, bro. That means if you smoke, if you go buy a pack of cigarettes now, you are willingly making a conscious decision to do something that you know has a high probability to have you talking through a hole in your throat.
Right, but isn't that the same thing with alcohol? Same thing with isn't the same thing with food? Isn't it like, you know, being obese?
No.
There's tons of, we know what the repercussions are, but for whatever reason, we still do them.
There's a lot of things that are okay in moderation, right? And there are pros to everything.
Sure.
But cigarettes just has none of that, bro. Like, no doctor will tell you, hey, a cigarette a week is fine. It's cool.
No, actually, a cigarette a week is not going to kill you.
Could.
No, I mean, like, even cigars. Cigars are bad for you.
Yeah, you don't inhale them, do you? You don't inhale
them. No, but you get throat cancer.
How? The cigar smoke never goes in my throat.
Of course it does.
Not any more than you do.
You get nasal cancer.
I don't inhale.
I don't even know. I just made
it doesn't
that up.
Go in my nose.
Nasal cancer.
None of the smoke goes in my mouth, cancer. Bro. I just put the cigar in my mouth and blow out.
Yeah, you could still get mouth cancer.
How?
Because whether you believe it or not, there's smoke in your mouth.
No, I go like this, bro. I have the cigar here. I go, hold my breath.
Yeah.
Everything's out. Everything's out. Nothing goes in, only out. So I'm wasting cigars, basically.
Yeah, that's not really smoking cigars. But.
No, I just like to look like I'm smoking a cigar because it looks cool. That's the trick. That's how these motherfuckers should have been smoking cigarettes. Just blowing out everything, not actually inhaling it. Yeah,
I smoked cigarettes for 20 years.
Yeah. So here's another thing, bro, that bothers me about people that smoke cigarettes.
And I was an athlete when I was a kid.
They say they want to quit, and they don't just stop. Like, just stop, bro.
Well,
every time you think about
that.
It doesn't matter. If you want to quit because you're going to have cancer and die, it doesn't matter how hard it is. Just stop.
Really?
Yeah.
It's not that easy, obviously.
No.
I mean, it's kind of like dieting, you know?
Well, that's what I mean, I'm on the journey now, but yeah, I just stopped.
Like
I love double cheeseburgers from McDonald's, but every time I want one now.
Then why would you wait so long?
It doesn't matter why I'm doing it now.
Of course it does, because it's not that easy. That's what I'm trying to say.
I just never really decided to do it. Now I decided.
Yeah, that's That's
like, I was talking to somebody recently, bro, and they told me their, like months ago, they told me their doctor told them they had to quit smoking, bro. Like, they're going along the path of definitely having lung cancer. I'm like, bro. And they're like, no, I'm trying. I'm like, bro. Like,
bro, I know people that
every time you think about smoking a cigarette, just be like, no.
I know people that witnessed their parents die from lung cancer and still smoke.
Crazy.
You know? Well, you know, I think there's like a, well, obviously there's a chemical addiction there that's not easily controlled.
It's all up here, bro. Everything is
willpower. I agree with that.
Everything is willpower.
It's
like how you said you decide every day not to be gay. That's hard for you, but you make that decision.
There's definitely a chemical addiction when it comes to smoking. And it's not only just a chemical addiction, there's a dopamine response that you have to fight. You go through withdrawals. Mm. Like, it's fucked up. I don't know if you've ever been addicted to, let's say, any kind of drug or any kind of...
I don't think I can be addicted to anything.
Yeah. Oh, huh? Okay. Well,
I don't know. I mean, people say that, you know, like weed.
Well, when you say that, so let me ask you then, why do you live the life you live?
In what way?
What do you mean in what way? In the way that you live your life, let's say, I'm sure that you would prefer to rather be, let's say, athletic. Why aren't you athletic?
Oh, laziness.
Okay. What else? I mean, like, it can't be just laziness.
That's pretty much it. Laziness, lack of discipline.
Yeah. But you do prefer to be athletic, right? You'd rather be fit than, let's say, fit?
Here's what I'd rather be just fat and lazy because it's easier. But the symptoms of being fat and lazy are not enjoyable. Right. Which is why I'm doing the thing now that I don't want to do, which is diet.
Right.
You know what I mean?
So how many times have you dieted in your life?
I don't know, bro.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's not easy, right?
I'm not. Nobody's ever saying that it's easy. I'm not saying it's
easy. It's more than just saying, well, why don't you just stop? Right? If it was that easy, then everybody just would, right?
I mean, put it this way. I'm a few weeks in now. I just stopped.
Yeah. But I mean, like, obviously the
most people that make it a few weeks with no cigarettes, yeah, the result's not instant.
Right.
Yeah. But I feel like for cigarettes, right?
You still could fail, right?
No, I don't think I can fail now.
Oh, okay.
I mean, the decision is too, it's never been this black and white, you know?
In your mind, yeah.
No, just it's not in my mind, it's reality.
So, like, I'm equating it to, like, when
You've actually been in positions with me where you've seen me turn down things that I would always eat, you know, and be happy to eat.
Right.
And there's no temptation there.
Yeah.
You know?
But I mean, if you look at track history, it would be rational to say and logical to say that obviously if you believe that it was that easy just to stop doing something, then you would have stopped a long time ago. You wouldn't have waited until you were 34 or however you are, 33. Because there's no point in doing that. That doesn't make logical sense to wait and put your health at risk and put, you know...
No. So I would probably disagree with that only because it's not until very recently that I've noticed, like, the effects of it. Like, the effects now are a lot more noticeable and a reality check. Yeah, exactly. As I age, you know, as I've gained more weight, as my kids are getting bigger and more active.
Like, I never noticed that my pants don't fit.
Yeah, no, I thought I was still growing, like, naturally. I'm like, oh, I must be getting taller. I need bigger jeans.
But, I mean, so, like... Agreeing with what you're saying. So here's where I kind of agree with what you're saying because I did smoke for almost 20 years and it took whatever it was. Actually, I think it was smoking weed, but it was up until the point where I made it up in my mind that I'm just not going to smoke anymore. And that's when I stopped.
Well, that's what it is, bro. And I think it's that easy for everybody. You just have to make the decision. And I think a lot of times we tell ourselves we're making a decision, but we don't really make the decision. Wanting and acting is two very different things.
Of course.
You know, like I could have wanted to like lose weight for a long time.
Yeah.
But I didn't take any action. And the action I took was fake action, you know, like fad, quick results action, not a real lifestyle change, you know?
Would you agree that if it was as easy as just say, hey, hang, look, you know, all you gotta do is just stop, then you would have just made that decision a long time ago. It's not that easy.
It's easy. A combination of maybe just, again, a reality check and then also the knowledge, you know, because for a long time I thought that, hey, these like little fad diets, like cutting out carbs completely or doing this or doing that was the way to go. But actually talking to a nutritionist and a health coach and really mapping out a plan and deciding is what makes it just easy now, you know?
Yeah. Fair enough.
Having that knowledge, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because again, it's not a big change. You know, like I said, the things that
it's
I used
huge
to like.
Change.
Well, I think the results will be huge.
Yeah.
But it's not a difficult change is what I should say. Yeah, it's a big change, but
you'd
not
be
really difficult.
Obviously you'd be the, and I'm sure you agree with this, you'd be the minority by saying it's not a big change to, because you can't, it's not necessarily just changing your diet, right? You have to change the way you think. You got to change the way that you, your behaviors have to change. You're like, you know, like it's like the shin
no,
bones
you,
connect to the knee bone.
You can just change your diet.
Not when it comes to, no, you can't. You got to change everything. Because everything's related. True. It is. It's very true.
It's not true, bro. Like,
yeah.
You can literally just change what you're taking into your body and get a result that way.
No, because you have to make conscious decision to actually change that. So you have to change the way you think first.
What?
If you're in the habit of waking up and, like, let's say, eating a certain way.
Yes.
If it's just habit for you, the very first thing that you have to change is your mindset.
No, because if you're in the habit of waking up every day and eating cereal and chocolate milk.
Right.
And now you just wake up every day and drink a glass of water and eat eggs.
But why would you do that?
Because right,
your mind changed.
All right. Now we're just being weird. I don't know.
Right. You're not going to just do that.
The only thing you're changing, the habit is the same. The only thing that's changing is what you're putting into your body.
Physically. Yeah.
Yes.
But you right, have so to are make you a conscious me? Decision to do that. You don't just wake up and do
no,
that.
No shit, dude.
Okay. Well, I'm just going to get on the same
right,
page here.
All right. So. What you're saying is that before your body can do something, you have to tell your brain to do it?
Yes.
Okay.
Which takes a lot.
Yes.
It does take a lot.
Then you win. I agree with you. Yes.
I mean, it's kind of like working out. You know,
right. Like lifting weights is not going to help you.
You have to change your mindset first.
You have to tell yourself to drive to the gym and lift the weights first.
Correct. Which might not be like an easy thing. That's the hardest thing for me.
Like
is going to
quitting
the gym.
Smoking is not really going
to
happen. Unless you tell yourself to not smoke the cigarette.
Yeah. And then there's like
nothing,
other things.
Gets by you, bro. Nothing gets by you. Dude.
There's other things that obviously change too. Like, you know, when it comes to making those conscious decisions, like you say, okay, I'm not going to eat X, Y, and Z, or I'm not going to smoke cigarettes anymore. Like personally, I had to make a decision to like, all right, hey, look, all my friends are going out. They're going to have a cigarette. I normally go out with them. I'm going to sit here and sit by myself while they do that. You know what I'm saying? Like there's a lot of other changes, behavioral changes.
So I think maybe for you it is like that is an effort, but I know a lot of previous alcoholics, dude, that used to be alcoholics, that when they made the decision to no longer drink,
right.
In order for them to succeed, they had to get rid of the excuses. And they have to get rid of the lack of accountability. And to me, the lack of accountability is saying, well, I can't go out with my friends because they're going to drink and I don't want to be in that situation.
Sure.
That's pussy shit. They decided that they weren't going to drink, so they would still come out and hang out with us as we drank. And because it was important to them, they just didn't drink. Even if they're around people. Like, for example, I can go out with you and George or have you guys around me and eat a bunch of eclairs and fucking donuts and shit.
Sure.
And it never even crosses my mind to say, man, I'm just going to have one. Do you get what I'm saying?
Right.
You know? So I think, and again, everybody's different, but I don't think that has to happen in order for you to be successful in quitting.
Well, put it this way. There's a reason for the 12-step process when you're addicted to shit, whether it be food, drugs, gambling. You know, there's a whole 12-step process. There's a lot of things that have to change.
That's for that program, and I'm sure that's helpful to a lot of people.
Addiction in general, for no matter if it's drugs, alcohol, or gambling, whatever.
But that is one way to fight addiction. It's not the only way.
It's probably the more successful way, right?
It's the more popular, well-known way. I don't know.
The most successful.
Popular and well-known doesn't equal success.
Well, if you can name another program that is more successful than the 12-step process when it comes to addiction.
Cold turkey.
That's definitely not more successful.
How did you stop smoking?
That
you
was
didn't
just
quit
me.
Cold turkey?
Just because I'm not a bitch.
Okay, so that's 100. In this room right now, 100% of the people that have been addicted to something quit cold turkey. You didn't go to a 12-step program.
No, I didn't have to. I'm not a bitch.
I used to smoke weed.
No,
I was
just kidding.
When I was younger, I was addicted to weed. Yeah. I just stopped. I didn't go to any program. I just stopped smoking weed.
Yeah, no, I believe that. I'm not taking anything away from anybody.
So I'm just saying, like, just because the 12-step program is one way to do it, I would never say that that's the
only. But it's
more
than one way. It's a very successful way that has been proven, like, over the years to help people.
How do you define its success? A lot of people
because
go
there's
and
not
take,
any. There's not anything else that even that compares to that. You can say cold turkey.
I mean, how do you say that? What numbers do you have, bro? You don't have any data.
Well, hold on. Wait, you're disputing the fact. Prove to me that there's something out there.
Let me finish my thought. No, because you have a bad habit of doing this. You prove something is fact with no evidence.
Everybody's very much aware of the 12-step process. Right. It's a very common thing.
Nobody knows what cold turkey is?
Everybody knows what cold turkey is. So prove to me, because you're the one that's saying that it's not, prove to me that there's another process out there.
I'm not saying it's not. I'm saying I don't know if it is. You're saying
you don't know if it is. You don't know if it is what?
If it's the most successful way of quitting something.
It's the most successful way I know.
Oh, okay, then. That's fine. As long as, if you can end it with that, then that's fine.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't know any other process that's more successful. Yeah.
My only beef is
I know people that have stopped doing things cold turkey.
I know more people that have done things cold turkey than 12 steps. It's actually not close now that I think of it.
Wow, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah. I bet you do too.
No. Yeah. You'd be the first person in my lifetime that
quit something cold turkey?
No, that claims that cold turkey is actually more successful.
Well, I don't know if it's more successful. I just know more people that have quit things cold turkey.
You'd be the first person in my life.
Interesting. If you had to guess,
yeah,
roughly how many people do you know that went through the 12-step program successfully and are no longer addicted to that vice that they had?
Right. I can just think of just smoking alone. Just more people.
Total. How many people you know that went through the 12-step program?
I don't know. I don't know numbers. What I'm saying is that over my lifetime, I know more people that have been successful through the 12-step process.
You don't have a number, though.
But no, I don't. Versus quitting cold turkey,
so,
and they always go back
don't,
to doing
I,
it.
And I don't want you to feel like attacked or annoyed when I get attacked like this, because honestly, I don't want you to feel intimidated because I'm so overpowering physically against
you're definitely not overpowering to me.
But I get real antsy, bro, and I get super tilted.
Yeah,
when
super tilted
when
that's a poker term.
Just when people state these things, bro, just without evidence, you know, like without any data to support it. Back to when we were you just felt emotionally that we should be able to stop a ballistics missile, you know what I mean? So it's like,
hold on.
I'm not going to get sidetracked by that conversation again. But that's kind of how I felt now when you were just saying, it's the most successful. Because you know about it and, you know people that went through it, doesn't mean it's the most successful. And then you start saying things like, oh, no, definitely more people have done that than the other. But you don't really know that.
150%.
But you don't know that.
I do know that.
You don't have any figures to support that.
There's a difference between not knowing something and being able to regurgitate it and can I pop off numbers for you? No, but do I know it? Of course I do.
How do you know, though?
Because I'm smart and I research shit and I read.
And everything you research had no data?
Were these recruitment videos for a 12-step program? Of course they did. I would never talk on something that I don't know.
Come to our program. It's the most successful program in the world. You're like,
listen.
It said it.
I don't know if you realize this by now, after all of our recordings, I don't speak on shit that I really don't know about, right? Just because I can't regurgitate the data, that doesn't mean that it's not true.
Bro, the last clip that we uploaded, you said it'd be cool if there was a way to measure how good somebody was at shooting three-pointers.
No, that's not what I said.
That's pretty close to what you said, bro.
I said off the dribble.
Roll the tape. And then you try to pinpoint it specifically. You're like, no. But I mean, like, if there was a way to really measure how good he shot when he had a 20/20 vision of the rim on a clear sunny day.
What? That's not. You just start framing it to make it make sense. You can't discredit what I'm saying because your lack of listening is, less than par.
My listening subpar. You don't know what subpar that word, bro. Less than par.
Yeah, less than par.
Less than par.
Because I specifically said a measurement for his off the dribble shot.
I bet that's a stat, though.
It's not a stat. I know it's not a stat.
Off the dribble 3 percentage?
Yeah, that's not a stat. Nobody ever measured that.
Versus catch and shoot?
I'm just saying off the dribble.
What's not off the dribble? Catch and shoot.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know.
How else would he get the ball to this position?
No, I'm saying
either he catches it or he dribbles and puts it there.
Off the dribbles 3 was 32%.
Yeah, nice.
Actually record that.
Yeah. Is there like a major stat for that? Like when you consider a basketball player, do they look at their off the dribble shot?
I think it just depends who's looking at that player, you know? Like you or I, that was my point. That.
Like there's not something measured, and that's where like Steph Curry
is measured. He just found it.
Well, no, okay.
Like to the average person, just talking, probably not. But
when you look at the back of a, let's say, I don't even know if there's any. are there like basketball cards anymore? Like
what?
A basketball card?
George, he's big in that card world.
Okay, so when you look at the back of a card, is there an off the dribble stat? No, of course not.
Mm.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh, you were talking about. Specifically on the back of trading cards.
No, I'm talking about major stats. Like
I didn't know that.
You know, with baseball. Yeah. Exactly. That's my whole point.
Can you still hear me? I might have just fucked with the wire by mistake. You sure you can hear me? Can I listen so I can make sure I hear?
So, like, when I'm talking about something, just because I can't regurgitate the stats and the data to back it up, that doesn't necessarily mean it's not true. But if it means it's not true,
no. So I disagree with you.
If you're disputing something, well, then I would question. Well, where are you getting that from? Because where I'm getting, let's say, but I'm not just saying me. I'm not just saying you. Disputing I'm just saying anybody.
Just because it's not your take doesn't mean you should be relieved of the requirement to fucking prove it. Yeah,
yeah. No, I understand,
how you feel, bro. You're just like, all right. Well, if you're arguing against me, prove it. No, that's not how it works, bro. If you're stating something as fact, and I say, how did you get that info? And you're just like, just because I know, then, bro, there's no credibility to what you're saying if you don't have.
Well,
I'm not even asking for specific figures. If you could just tell me
there's no
anything,
credibility
bro.
To the person that is ignorant of the subject.
Yeah, but I'm ignorant of the subject.
Clearly.
Yeah.
So we agree.
100%, bro.
I'm not ignorant of the subject.
Oh, you're just ignorant of the facts. That's all, bro. No. You know a lot about addiction, but not what works to cure it, baby.
There are a lot of things that, in any case.
Can you look up 12 steps versus cold turkey?
I did. There's not really much information
on it. You put it in just like that in Google, 12 steps versus cold turkey?
I would almost.
I don't care if there's not. Is there anything? There's got to be something. You're telling me Google put zero results?
Cold turkey is not a viable.
It's the only way, bro. The 12 steps just work you up.
Maybe for you.
The 12 steps get you to a point where it's cold turkey. Because eventually you just stop. No matter what, no matter how you frame it, eventually you have to get to the point where you decide that's the last one. No?
No.
No.
That's not cold turkey. That's not cold turkey when you take steps towards it.
Probably right.
I don't have any data to back that up.
No, then you're shit, bro. You're an idiot.
Yeah, you're a fucking moron.
You're just a fucking ignorant, metrosexual, gelled hair, back, funeral, white jacket, dick.
What?
Funeral? I like that jacket. I know, funeral, white jacket. You're like, wedding, bro? Would an angel die?
What? You Billy Idol, like nice day for a white wedding.
You fucking Tina Turner, bro. Just beat your ass down the river. You want some ice, bro? What are you drinking there?
Agua.
Terramana, baby. Terramana Reposado. It's the Rock's tequila. I typically stay away from like celebrity brand tequilas because they're shit. Like Casamigos. But this is good. I like this.
That's actually not bad at all.
What do you got for us, George? Nada?
Not really.
What were you looking up?
If there's a difference between 12-step program and success.
He was looking up if there's any results that point to the 12 steps as being successful.
Yeah.
And he can't find anything.
Well, let's use a little common sense here. When's the last time you saw a cold turkey meeting?
You're so fucking stupid, bro.
Hey, let's go to the cold turkey meeting.
I wonder. I mean, it's crazy though because it's again. I know people that have went through the programs and failed miserably.
Of course,
you know, and I know some that have done well, but I know a lot of people that just stopped.
You're talking about anything, whether it be drugs.
Yeah, I mean anything.
You know anybody that ever stopped heroin cold turkey?
I do.
Shut the fuck up.
I do.
I was going to say, who? No, not who, but.
Dad. How do you stop? He died.
He OD'd. Well, that is cold turkey.
That's cold as fuck turkey, bro. Oh, shit. That's terrible. But no, I mean, usually they, I don't know if you would consider the, like that methadone shit, you know, they need that to kind of, I mean, I don't know if they need it. I'm not an expert in it, but usually people get addicted to heroin. They can't just stop because their body kind of needs a little bit of methadone so they don't get fucked up or die. I don't know.
Yeah, they go, it's actually pretty weird. The bro, withdrawal
symptoms. That's a crazy one, dude, that people start. It's like, dude, that's like the, I tried a lot of different drugs, but to me, that's kind of, that's like the no of drugs. Like, don't try that one. The only option is death. Like.
Yeah, normally.
Yeah. It's like, what do you think the fucking OD rate is on people that do heroin? It's got to be so high.
Yeah, that I'm actually afraid of ever doing it because I think I would like it.
I'm sure. It's amazing, bro. Yeah, like for people to say, like, all right, so if I do this, there's an 87% chance I'm going to OD soon? Well, fuck it. Let's give it a shot.
No, I'm saying imagine feeling, like, so good, like, that where life, it doesn't feel like life anymore. You know, like, who wouldn't like that? You know what I'm saying? Who wouldn't like that feeling? It scares the shit out of me, too. That's why I don't do it.
It scares me just hearing about it, thinking of, like, what are we doing? Why are we doing all this?
The timeline for withdrawal is nasty. Day 1 to 2, you have muscle aches, shaking, diarrhea, insomnia, anxiety, panic attacks. Day 3 to 4, you have insomnia, abdominal cramping, nausea, vomiting, sweating, and shivers. And then day 6 and 7, you have exhaustion, panic attacks, and psychological symptoms.
When is the now you're good, no more symptoms day?
I don't even know. It's got to be 2 weeks.
That's tough, man. Imagine that.
I'll tell you what. You know what, though? You know what you should do when somebody is, if that's it, if it's 2 weeks, when somebody's sober and they want to, exactly, just fucking throw them in a cage, lock them up for 2 weeks, ignore them. Ignore the cries, make sure they're fed, make sure they have water, and then they're clean.
Isn't that every recovery center ever?
Pretty much.
Is it?
Yeah.
I mean, you're just trapped in a place you're not supposed to leave. You're monitored. You have security, and they're telling you what to eat, drink, and...
Well, it's not as bad as, like, throwing in, like, isolation.
Yeah, it's isolation.
But...
Because the problem is you get a lot of these places that have, like, corrupt security or nurses. They'll sneak you a little something, you know what I mean?
But you know what? Here's a whole different side of the conversation. It just goes to show how tough, like, really life is that so many people look to escape.
Is it how tough life is or how weak people are?
Probably a combination of both. I don't necessarily, I don't judge like this, not judge, that's the wrong word.
Yeah, so
I don't know if it's people.
Don't judge life like that.
I think it's just, it's life. Like, life is just tough.
Or
like,
is it life a mindset? It could be a mindset, bro. Like, what is life? Like, what makes it hard, bro? The mindset. Because there are people with nothing that are happy.
Who?
I don't know, bro. You need me to name somebody?
Well, quantify what you're saying.
I'm gonna go to the other extreme. There are people that have everything, bro. You know, like that are unhappy, that kill themselves. That dude Twitch, you know, like Ellen's fucking black dancer dude there.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
To the general person, he's got everything. He's got everything you could dream of and want. Beautiful family, a lot of money, career doing what he loves, still decided it wasn't enough, killed himself.
Yeah.
So, supposedly. I did read somewhere that he had info on the Clintons, but you never know. And then there
really?
Are people...
Is that, like, legit? Or you really read that? Or you just bullshit?
Oh. And then there are people that, even from my perspective, bro, like, have nothing. And I'm like, why the fuck is this motherfucker always so happy? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Personally, just obviously this is opinion, I think too many people seek happiness from the outside with things, with material things.
For real, bro.
Which is short-lived. It's very short-lived. Like, yeah, you want those, you want that car. But once, after a while, you know. It's just a car.
I was even thinking about this on a different scale. Funny, as I was driving home last night, I was thinking about, like, my family. Not my family here that I spend every day with. My extended family, you know.
Sure.
Like my cousins, my aunts, and my uncles. And how since my grandmother passed away, you know, a while ago, 6-7 years ago, and, it kind of, that was like the moment where the family stopped coming together, you know, a couple times a year for Thanksgiving or for Christmas, you know, because prior to that, it was every year, you know, there's fucking 30 people in, you know, in one house where we're there every single year, a couple of times, you know, and that happened. And then I thought about how, you know, I got a couple of cousins, man, that, you know, we grew up together. I'm talking, you know, like through my adolescent life up until we were fucking 14, 15, 16 years old.
Right.
We, you know, like there were years we lived together and the years we didn't live together.
Sure.
We lived directly across the street, you know, so we're spending every day together, you know, so we grew up a lot closer than a lot of cousins, you know, grow up. And there's a couple of them, man, I haven't seen in fucking years. and they live here in Rhode Island. You know,
really?
So yeah, dude. So it's like, and it's a really weird thing. So I'm driving home last night and I'm like, man, I spent a lot of time with people that in the grand scheme of things don't matter to me. You know? Like, and I don't mean like they don't matter, their lives, I mean, they, obviously they matter.
Yeah.
But if I were to die tomorrow,
right,
they'd maybe put a nice Facebook post and that'd be it. They'd go on with their lives.
You
know?
Of course.
And the same thing with them. You know, like if they would die tomorrow, I'd be like, damn, that's crazy. And then I'd move on with my life. But then I have people that I'd be like lost. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if something happened to and I don't spend any time with them. And I don't know. It kind of just hit me, bro. I think that's why I messaged you. I'm like, bro, like I was telling you I hate people last night. It's not that I don't hate people. I almost felt like, dude, like I'm upset with myself because I feel like I'm wasting time with people that don't matter and neglecting the people that do matter. You know what I mean?
I understand. Like so, there's people that obviously are in your life that add value to your life. And then there's other people that they just exist and they're just kind of there, you know?
As like time killers almost, you know what I mean? Just like a silly fun way to pass the time.
Right.
You know?
And there's obviously people in your life that legit care about you. And then there's other people that, you know, they don't give a shit about you. I mean, that's just the reality, I guess, of life, you know?
Yeah.
So anyways, I've had so many.
I gotta stop spending so much time with you, bro. Sorry.
I've had so many people in my life come in and out of my life where like it's almost like personally you become numb to it almost to some degree. I've really close friends from Jersey that I don't talk to anymore. Close friends in the military that I don't really talk to anymore. I guess that's just life, you know?
Yeah. I think it was just, you know, like, I don't know. And it's weird because as I'm driving, I just called my cousin, you know, one of them that I haven't
spoke to in a long time.
Maybe in the past four.
Did they pick up?
Yeah.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah. He goes,
fuck you want?
I go, yo. I'm like, yo, what's up, man? He goes, who's this? I go, it's your cousin, bro. You don't have my number saved? I'm like, it's Josh. And he's like, oh, yeah, of course, man. You know, he's like, oh, what's going on? You know, we're bullshitting a little bit. And then it's weird because, like, I don't know, man. Maybe some of it was, like, shame because there's no excuse for it. You know, like, I've, from my family sense, I've always kind of made myself an outcast. You know what I mean? Like, I've just, like, been the guy to not show up to, like, barbecues and shit like that. Just,
right.
You know, just for whatever reason, you know?
Yeah. You have that right.
And like, you know, what happens, though, over time is you stop getting invited. You stop getting notified.
Sure.
You stop. You're not involved. You know, you're kind of, like, distant. So, you know, I'm just talking to him. And I'm bullshitting. I'm like, man, it's been a while, you know. And he's like, yeah, dude, like, why don't we get together with, you know, our Pepe, my grandfather, and let's play a poker game. You know, we did that, a year and a half ago or something. It's a great time, you know, just my grandfather, he's getting older. He plays cards, you know, so we go sit in his fucking smoky-ass little kitchen, bro.
Yeah.
This dude, talk about fucking old. This guy's 85 years old. My grandmother passed away to cancer. He's pounding cigarettes all the time, bro. His walls are yellow.
Yellow?
But, yeah, his balls are yellow. Walls are yellow. I walk in the house, bro. I get home. I take my jacket off, and I got just a T-shirt on. I throw my jacket immediately in the washing machine, and my girl is still like, bro, you smell like cigarettes. That's all I can smell. You know what I mean? The whole house smells like cigarettes now. But anyway, so I'm bullshitting with my cousin on the phone, and then we, like, say our goodbyes, and he goes, hey, by the way, man, if you're not, you know, if you don't have plans for Christmas Eve, he's like, why don't you come by Bobby Ann's house, another cousin of mine? You know, he goes, I'm going to be over there. So-and-so's going to be over there. He's like, last year was the first time we kind of started to get it together again, and, you know, so-and-so, Scott's going to be there. Eddie, Robert, you know, his kid's going to be there. Auntie Tina's going to be there. So I'm like, damn, like, I felt like it was almost like a chance to fucking get back in the swing of thing and get around people that really matter to me, you know, and spend more time with these people versus
letting
life go by. 100%, bro. Yeah. I was thrilled when he said that. You know, part of me was almost kind of like, damn, you know, like I put myself so far away that they didn't even tell me about it. You know, I'm like, wow, my family's getting together. I didn't even know about it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So part of me was kind of like I felt hurt, but there was really nobody to blame for that. You know what I mean? Because all the times I did get invited, I didn't show up. You know?
Right.
So it felt good that he let me know. So I was just like, bro, that's awesome.
Contact my cousin. For the most part, I think most people. Well, again, but this is just my personal experience.
My bad. Go.
Oh, I'm sorry. Were you?
I was gonna say that's. I think that's like the beautiful thing about family, is. You the bullshit doesn't matter. Yeah. They just pick up.
You know, where you left
family,
off.
Yeah, family just pick. No, like, they literally just pick up, bro. They just pick up the phone and say, bro, come. You know what I mean? Like, come, like, your family, bro.
Right.
Not like a, hey, I haven't seen you in 3 years. I got too much going on for you. It's come home. You know what I mean? Like, that's what it felt like, bro. When he said that to me, it was like, of course, bro, just come home. You know?
I think I can relate to that in a sense, like, where, like, you know me. I'm kind of a loner, you know? And I think it's just because of my worldview. I think a lot of people are just mostly self-serving, right? They do what they want to do, right? Not necessarily... They're not looking out for me. They're not looking out for you. They're just doing what they want to do. And you either have to, like, kind of find... And you have to accept that, right? Yeah. Or just not be a part of it.
Everybody's favorite radio station is WIIFM.
Right, exactly.
You know what that means?
No.
What's in it for me?
Okay, there you go.
Sorry.
I you know what? This actually brings up like almost a deeper conversation. I feel the same exact way in relationships where you hear it all the time. I've heard it my whole life where... people are, they're like, well, what does this person have to offer me? And that's what they look for. They look for what that person, as opposed to, let's say, a selfless love and say, what do I have to offer that person? How can I add value to that person's life? So even when it comes to friendships, it's kind of the same way, you know, friendships, whether it be, you know, a deep friendship, a kind of a surfacey friendship, most people look at it from their own perspective, like, all right, what am I getting out of this? Mm. You know, and when I recognize that pushes me away from somebody. I'm like, you know what? I'm not here necessarily. Like, I hope I add value to people's lives in some way, shape, or form. But
like at the poker table, you definitely add value to my life.
You like you add value to my wallet.
Yeah, bro. About 3 big blinds an hour. You at?
Yeah. Like so, being single, right? Being a male single. Sexy as fuck, intelligent,
I feel you,
and successful. I would never look for like a, you know, if a woman said to me, you know, like, oh, what does this guy have to offer me? I'd just cut her off. Like, I don't give a shit how good looking she is. Nothing at all. Yeah, like you, I don't even want to talk to you. Yeah. I have nothing for you.
Yeah, I'm, you know, with relationships, man. If you, I'm a friend, you know, because a good friend of ours, you know, and I won't put her on blast, but it's like. Coming from one relationship and then getting back into another, you know, long term and then getting back into another. And I feel like a lot of people, not even just women in general, are not equipped to be alone, you know, or don't understand how to be alone. And there's a lack of like just self-love and actual happiness. So they rely on somebody else to provide that happiness for them because they have no like peace and solitude, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I feel like, dude, and I've had the conversations with people that I know like that, even one of our other good friends, you know, and I explained to him, I explained to her, I'm like, yo, I really think like just if you're asking me, like, figure your shit out first, you know, like be alone for a while before you get somebody else and then tell me that you're happy again. You know, this person is the sweetest. They're making me happy again. It's like, bro, you can't go from like being miserable, right? Mm-hmm. When you're alone for whatever reasons you are. Mm. And then just boom, now somebody in your life is making you happy again. Because you know what's going to happen? And it's going to happen is that person is going to leave.
Eventually.
They're going to leave or they're going to die.
Right.
And then you got to be good. You have to be good with yourself. You know what I mean?
You think happiness is internal or external? Or
It depends, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I'm happy when I'm internal, my girl. Of course it's internal, bro. Like, literally, it's 100% internal. Like, I cannot... Yeah. There's nothing I could do to you right now that makes you... You have to feel happy. I can't do anything to you to make you happy.
Right.
I'm actually trying to teach my son this a lot, you know what I mean? Like, because he gets upset, you know what I mean? He's 13, he's going through puberty and shit. He's like, you know, but a lot of times he'll get upset, and I'm like, you know, like, bro, you have to... And he's like, well, this is how... I'm like, dude... Everything outside is outside. Literally, it may feel unconscious, but every time you get upset, like you're getting upset. I can't get you upset. Like I cannot. It's like, oh, self-esteem. I'm like Cat Williams said, bro. Hmm. Like I can't affect your self-esteem. Bitch, it's your esteem about your motherfucking self.
That's right.
How do I affect that? But it's funny. You know, it's funny because it's a joke, but it's true. Bitch, it's called self-esteem.
It's very true. Very, very true.
Yeah, so I would definitely say internally.
Yeah.
But it's weird because I don't know if I believe that truly because I like to think that I can assist in making people happy, you know, making people laugh. You know, think about it. You're a funny guy. You know, you're a class clown. You're a jokester. We're pretty, you know, like there's a lot of times I'm making jokes and it's I like making myself laugh.
Right, yeah.
But
yeah.
It feels good to make other people laugh and make other people smile.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's fully internal, you know? But it's weird. What do you think?
Yeah, I think it's... I do think it's internal. I think, you know, every day you have to wake up and decide what kind of, like, day you're going to have and whether you're going to let things affect you and or whether you're not. Essentially, I think life happens to everybody, right? In the same exact way, in different ways, if that makes sense. Like, death happens to everybody. And it really comes down to, and I don't want to sound cliche and, like, all, like, Hallmarky and whatever, but it's just how you handle those things and how you perceive those things. You can either let them drive you or you can let them, you know, crush you. I mean, I'm sure you can think of, just like me, myself, like there's tons of things that I can think of in my lifetime that I have every, in my head, I'm justified to believe a certain way and act a certain way. And, but are those things healthy and like whatever? I can decide to do those things or I can decide to change. I can decide to try to, you know, be better, do better, that kind of thing. Generally inside, personally, I think I'm happy, right? Now, are there things externally that would make me unhappy? Yeah, like the State of the Union. There's certain things that make me horribly unhappy, but does it affect my, like, inner happiness? No, I don't think. It'll take a lot to affect my inner happiness. I'm pretty secure and okay with, you know, internally. Well, I don't know. I was thinking about transitioning, but no, I wasn't thinking about transitioning.
That's a clip.
All right, man. Well, you got anything else you want to say to the people?
No.
All right. All I would ask is that if you enjoy the show, like, leave a comment, send us a check, whatever you want to do. And we love you. Thank you for listening. George, you did great today.